No.
No, she's not here.
Good evening and welcome to our board meeting for May 21st, 2012. Will the Deputy Village Clerk please take the roll?
Mayor Broda.
Present.
Trustee Boyle.
Here.
Trustee Kowitzel.
Here.
Trustee LaFond.
Here.
Trustee Modath.
Here.
Trustee Schmidt.
Here.
Trustee Young.
Here.
Village Manager Sprecher.
Here.
Administrative Services Director Ertmuth.
Here.
Finance Director Schiller. Here. Village Attorney Silverman.
Here.
And I'm Deputy Clerk Curran.
Please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. At this point in time, I will turn the meeting over to Deputy Clerk Curran.
Welcome. Visitors are most welcome to all meetings of the Village Board. Persons wishing to discuss an item that is on the agenda may address the board at the time the item is being discussed. Please raise your hand when the item is announced and wait to be recognized by the mayor. It is requested that, if possible, one spokesperson for a group be appointed to present the views of the entire group. Anyone wishing to discuss a topic that is not on the pre-printed agenda may address the Village Board during the open forum portion of the meeting. Speakers who are recognized are asked to step to the podium and state their name, address, and the group they are representing prior to addressing the Village Board. There will be a 5-minute time limit per speaker. And at this time, it's requested that all cell phones and pagers please be turned off. Thank you. Looking at our sign-in sheets, we have one person who would like to speak to electric aggregation. I will need meeting minute approval this evening for the Village Board regular meeting of May 7th, 2012.
I move to approve the meeting minutes as presented.
Second.
There's a motion and second. Hearing no further discussion, all those in favor indicate by saying aye.
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 Those opposed? Hearing none, motion carries.
We have no raffles this evening. Looking at our meeting announcements, unless otherwise noted, meetings are at 7 p.m. and are located at the Village Hall. The Economic Development Commission will meet tomorrow, May 22nd at 4:30 p.m. The next Village Board meeting will be June 4th, 2012. And a reminder that the Village offices will be closed for Memorial Day, May 28th, and the Memorial Day parade, ceremony, and picnic begin at 11 a.m. That ends my portion of the meeting.
Thank you, Deputy Clerk Curran. Going to my portion of the agenda, the first item we have on the agenda is the DuPage County Hounds baseball team, and I would ask Joe to come out and say a few words to us.
I thought he was talking about you. Hello.
Okay, hello everyone. Thanks, Mr. Mayor, for having me here tonight. This is our new mascot, Paige, for the DuPage County Hounds baseball team. We're here tonight because our first home game is coming up in about a week and a half. It's next Friday at 7 o'clock at the sports complex. I'm happy to report for that first weekend. We're doing fantastic in terms of ticket sales. We have less than 100 actual seats left for the first game. We have less than 100 seats left for the second game, which is on Saturday. And the Sunday game, we're on our way to hopefully selling that game out as well. Right now, in total, we have about 10 games that are nearly sold out right now. You know, our staff has been out there, and a lot of people we meet are out there just talking about the team itself. We have pocket schedules, little boxes, and little cards inside of it with a schedule on it that pages hold, and those are starting to make their way around the area, Lisle, Woodridge, Downers Grove, Naperville. We also have postcards that some of you actually might have gotten in the mail talking about the team. We targeted certain postal routes in Lisle and a couple of the routes over in Woodridge and Naperville as well, depending on where it landed in terms of the sports complex. And Paige will actually be out at the Memorial Day Parade, too.
Oh, he will.
Right. Yeah, okay. So he'll be out there running around.
Well, with that, I want to thank you and Paige for coming here today to talk about the team. Personally, I'm excited because it's a very enjoyable event to go out there and watch some baseball and watching young kids, adults almost, really playing some good hard baseball, because these are our potential future baseball players that we may be seeing in the future, and they get an opportunity to play where people actually come out and look for them and even do scouting for them. So I think it's a tremendous opportunity, and I thank you for bringing the team to the Village of Lisle, and I personally look forward to the first game. Anybody have any questions of Paige? Maybe Paige. Paige has a hard time talking sometimes.
Yeah, he does.
Also seeing, I think.
Yeah. The other thing I'd like to point out, too, you brought up future major leaguers. You know, we have Ron Kittle owns a team in our league, and he's going to be out for the All-Star game. We have Bob Denier, who coached the Cubs last year. He's coaching another team in our league, so he will be out there on Saturday's game coaching. So it's really cool to have those guys out there. Brings more people into the community itself.
Okay.
Which is great. So,
with that, thank you for coming tonight. Maybe you want to pass out some schedules to the board members so they can
have it for their personal pockets. We'll leave the rest of them up there if anybody
okay.
does want any at all.
We appreciate that.
Yeah.
Thank you. Oops.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good luck.
I already have one from the press conference. Okay. Well, thank you so much.
Good luck.
Paige and Joe. Take care now. I'm going to add one item to this portion of the agenda. We happen to have with us tonight County Board Member Michael Ladone, who's representing District 2. He's here to introduce himself publicly and say a few words. Michael, please take the podium.
Thank you. And good evening, Mayor Broda and Village Trustees and citizens of Lisle. As I mentioned before, my name is Michael Ladone, and I am your new representative for District 2 on the DuPage County Board, having been appointed just a couple months ago at the end of February. And I wanted to thank Mayor Broda and all of you trustees for allowing me just a few moments of your time tonight to introduce myself and to your citizens here in Lisle. I'm honored to have been selected to serve you, and it is my goal to do my utmost to make sure that the services and benefits of the county are brought to both the citizens of Lisle and to your elected representatives. And although my tenure on the board will be short, I wish to make myself available to this board as a resource for county government. I'm fortunate to serve on a number of different committees on the county: stormwater, finance, development, which we had talked about a little bit earlier this evening. And it is my goal to make sure that all of you, if you have questions or if you have needs from county, can come to me and I can be here to serve your needs. So again, I am very honored to be here this evening. I again wish to thank Mayor Broda for having me here tonight. It was a pleasure to have met all of you. And if I can be of service to you or of your citizens, please feel free to call on me. Thank you so much.
Thank you for coming and introducing yourself. We appreciate that.
Thank you.
Certainly do.
Now we'll go on to the omnibus vote agenda. Does anyone wish to have an item pulled from the omnibus vote agenda? If not, can I have a motion, please?
I move to place agenda items 3B, 1 through 13 inclusively as the omnibus vote agenda. Further, I move that all items be considered together as the omnibus vote agenda.
Second.
There's a motion and second. Hearing no further discussion, I will ask the Deputy Village Clerk to please take the roll.
Trustee Young.
Aye.
Trustee Boyle.
Aye.
Trustee Kuitzel.
Aye.
Trustee LaFon.
Aye.
Trustee Modaf.
Aye.
Trustee Schmidt.
Aye.
Mayor Broda.
Aye, and motion carries.
I move to adopt agenda items 3B, 1 through 13 inclusively on the omnibus vote agenda in a single group pursuant to the omnibus vote procedure specified in the Illinois Municipal Code.
Second.
There's a motion and second. Again, hearing no further discussion, will the Deputy Village Clerk please take the roll?
Trustee Young.
Aye.
Trustee Boyle.
Aye.
Trustee Kuitzel.
Aye.
Trustee LaFon.
Aye.
Trustee Modaf.
Aye.
Trustee Schmidt.
Aye.
Mayor Broda.
Aye, and motion carries. Thank you very much. We'll move on to our next item on the agenda, which is the public hearing for the electric aggregation program. At this time, I'll ask the Deputy Village Clerk to please read the public hearing notice.
The Village of Lisle will hold a public hearings on May 21st, 2012 and June 4th, 2012 at 7 o'clock p.m. or soon thereafter as the agenda permits in the boardroom of the Village Hall located at 925 Burlington Avenue, Lisle, Illinois. A referendum was passed on March 20, 2012 authorizing the Village to arrange for the supply of electricity for its residential and small commercial retail customers who do not opt out of the program. The purpose of the public hearings is to hear and receive public commentary on the Village of Lisle's plan of operation and governance for its municipal electric aggregation program. The plan will describe how electric supply offers will be provided and to all applicable residential and small commercial customers on an equal treatment basis. The plan will meet any requirements established by law concerning aggregated services offered. A copy of the proposed plan is available for review on the Village's website at www.villageoflisle.org or in the Village Hall offices during regular business hours, 8 a.m. to 4:30 p.m. Monday through Friday. Written and oral comments will be accepted at the hearings. All persons interested in these proceedings are invited to be heard.
With that, I'll introduce...
I'll go ahead and start.
Okay.
Good evening. Tonight we're taking another step forward in an opportunity to provide residents and small businesses with a lower electric supply rate. On March 20, 2012, a majority of voters requested that the Village seek lower electricity rates for those residents and small businesses that do not opt out. Staff has worked with its consultant, NYMEC, to draft a plan of operation and governance. And this evening, Sharon Durling from NYMEC is here to provide an overview of our aggregation plan, outline bidding options, and answer any questions from the board and the public. So with that, I'll introduce Sharon Durling from NYMEC.
Thank you. Good evening, trustees and mayor. I am Sharon Durling with NYMEC, that's for Northern Illinois Municipal Electric Collaborative, and you are joining about 244 other municipal entities who in March of this year voted to move forward with an aggregation program. So it's not exactly, you know, an unusual or cutting edge thing to do. It's a program that our state legislators made available in an act about two or three summers ago to try to take advantage for residents of deregulation of electricity in Illinois that mostly commercial entities were taking advantage of up to that time. And to give you a little background, last year 19 cities and villages engaged in municipal aggregation programs. My firm and our partner worked with 15 of those, all of which today are enjoying significant savings off the current ComEd rate. And when I say ComEd rate, just to remind listeners that ComEd has not generated or supplied any electricity to us in Illinois for the last 5 years. They deliver and will continue to deliver and be our deliver, maintain the networks and wires that bring the electricity on home to us. But they have not supplied electricity. Exelon, their parent, is a supplier and has about 23 competitors that bring supply residential electricity. So we've already gone to bid for some of the early of our 61 cities and villages we're working with. Just a note, ComEd has recently, again, ComEd, the Illinois Power Agency, but it's commonly called the ComEd rate, incorrect nomenclature, but that's what the folks call it. So I'll say that rate has just recently been increased for the energy year, the next 12 months that begin June 1st. And that rate is increasing from 7.73 cents to 8.23 cents. There's another purchased electricity adjustment, a half cent added onto that. So it's increasing quite a bit. At the same time, electric rates have been enjoying multi-year lows, which brings your percentage of savings even greater. We expect your residents would be able to enjoy once you go to bid. Presumably more than 40%. I would say 40 would be a baseline of percent off the supply portion of their electric bill, which is about 70% of the total bill. So we will go to bid, and there are various options, you know, 1, 2, and 3 years. We have gone to every residential electric supplier that is regulated by the Illinois Commerce Commission to present electricity. I think it's 24, and we have vetted those and selected those that some, you know, opted not. They're not, their business model maybe isn't to deliver aggregated electricity, but we will bring bids to you from all players who have participated in aggregation programs in the state of Illinois. Some are smaller private businesses, some are publicly traded, and have great, deep experience in aggregation across many states. So we'll present you with prices, 1, 2, and 3-year pricing, you know, variety of entities that are all, as I said, approved by the ICC. And there are a few options that I can address any questions, but I'll just say briefly, you could choose to accept a civic contribution or not that would cut in a little bit to the savings you could present to your residents. You could choose, and we are highly recommending that you elect a supplier that would guarantee that if during any point of your contract the ComEd rate were to drop, it's at 8.5 now, below your contracted rate, which we expect would be 4 cents and change, approximately, that residents would have their new lower rate matched. In other words, let me just say that again more clearly. Should at any point during the term of your contract the ComEd rate drop below the rate you contract, residents would never be caught paying, you know, a dollar more than they would have had you not gone to contract. So we're urging, we'd recommend that, and most of our suppliers offer that guarantee. A few other things, early termination fees range from $0 to $25, relatively nominal, but you may get a little bit more aggressive rate were you to accept, you know, a small fee for residents to leave. Just to put it into perspective, for a village of population with about 8,000 roughly households, your savings where rates are today could cumulatively for a year easily achieve $2.5 million, maybe in the direction of $3-3.5 million cumulative savings for the residents that would remain here. So I think it's fine that the voters presented and that you presented that to the voters to enjoy those savings. And I'm happy to respond to any questions you or the public may have.
Okay, well, we'll deal with the board first. The board have any questions they'd like to ask before we go out to the public?
I got a couple of real quick ones. You could opt for a supply of energy of a portion of it being green generated, could you? And we chose not to do that, did we not? Or is that still an option to be discussed?
We could present those pricing options. I know you're asking your colleagues, but I'm sorry.
Well, I'm asking both. I don't know if we have decided, and if not, when do we decide?
It need not be determined until you see the pricing, by the way.
Oh, okay.
My recollection was that there wasn't definitive direction. I thought that the preference appeared to be to get the lowest rate, period, but that's why we're talking tonight.
But will the bids come in with some portion? I mean, do people bid some portion green and are their rates competitive with people who...
Good question. First, I'll just say that the state of Illinois requires, or the ICC requires, everyone gets at least 7%, what I'll call green energy. So that's just the minimum baseline. We will present you with pricing for 1, 2, and 3 years, and then pricing for 25% renewable sources, 50 and 100%. So you could elect a portion of green or renewable energy. The pricing, I would say, is relatively low. It's a market that's pretty thinly traded, and those are RECs that you purchase to represent brown green energy. And the pricing, just to give you an idea, is roughly a little less than 0.1 cents. How does that translate? Maybe around $10 annually per electric account, just to put it in round numbers.
And anybody who was qualified to supply electricity in the state will be allowed to bid on this contract?
They will be, and we have presented RFQs, you know, some months ago to find out who is interested, and many are not participating at all and didn't respond.
They're prerogative, yes. But anybody could come in and participate.
If they are regulated and certified by the Illinois Commerce Commission, yes.
And if there was a penalty for discontinuation, how would that work with somebody who moved?
No penalty if you move. Okay. There would be no penalty because the account would be closed in this vicinity. If the person moved to another state, find no problem. If they move to another village in the area, they might ask and be able to enroll in that village's aggregation program, but no termination fee.
Okay, that's all I have.
Trustee LaFond first. I'll go ahead. Next, Trustee Boyle.
Your recent, your clients have signed up recently. What savings have they enjoyed?
There's one
percentage-wise.
Yeah, there's one entity that's hit 50%. Villages with, you know, very large use per home, very large homes, can command, it's economies of scale, they just can command lower prices. We would take your actual load based on the last 12 months of actual use by Lisle residents, and so it would be priced according to your load. So we've seen between, I'd say, 42 and maybe one hit 50%, but generally around 44, 45% we have locked in. That's correct. And those are, by the way, two-year terms. We could get bigger savings for 1 year. Most villages are opting for a little bit longer, two-year terms.
I see. To opt into the program, is there any fee at all?
None.
None. Okay. Thank you.
Trustee Boyle.
I assume this is controlled by the ICC, but seeing that we are going into a competitive marketplace, if there ever was a supply problem, do we have guarantees once we leave Exelon's system, where I assume they have guaranteed us electricity for the duration? Now that we've left them, we're in a competitive environment. Could we ever be left with musical chairs and having troubles with not enough electricity?
That's an interesting question. Commonwealth Edison is the provider of last resort, Polar, P-O-L-R, and they were required by law to deliver electricity, you know, unless they have issues with some terrorist event or something with the grid. They're required to deliver electricity. Should your supplier lose its generating source through some terrorist activity, you're still on the grid. You would continue, there would be no flickering of lights. You would continue to see, the flow would not be aborted or interrupted whatsoever, should Commonwealth Edison do its job. If the supplier, say it were a small private company, you're a little concerned about the credit and were it to close or file for bankruptcy, I guess the worst scenario would be you would go back to bid with a new supplier, or maybe for a term your supply would be coming through at the ComEd rate. So the flow would not be interrupted whatsoever.
There's a guarantee for the ComEd rate is what you just said.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Trustee Modav.
You mentioned that we would negotiate a contract that said that we would never pay more than the ComEd rate.
Yes, we have engaged already this year in contracts with companies that will only guarantee to always match the ComEd rate. For 1 year, it's kind of a non-event. Currently, rates are in the 4 cent and change with the ComEd rate, June 1st moving up to 8.5. Suppliers will state in their contract that they will either match should that ComEd rate drop below, let's say you contract at 4.9 cents, should in 2 years the ComEd rate drop to 4.8 cents, for example, that supplier is required in the contract to match that ComEd rate or release back to the ComEd.
Have you negotiated any contracts that guarantee a margin?
None. Okay. No. And I will just say a few villages have accepted a contract with no guarantee. Interesting, but that's been accepted. I guess the confidence that the spread will remain as it is.
I do have a question. I don't see any of your hands. A question. You had said we're on the grid. So if we had opted out to get green energy or renewable energy, that's what our customers are paying for, the Village of Lisle is paying for. There's really no guarantee that the supplier that is getting our money, we're using its actual energy that it's producing.
I'd be happy to respond to that. Once an electron is born, whether it's born, I'm sorry, I'm going in with sort of childish storytelling here a little bit, if it comes from coal or whether it comes from solar or wind, an electron, you can't differentiate that, right? It's all the same. So how do you know what's poured into the grid? What was its resource? There is a nonprofit entity called Green E. I think it's green-e.org or something close to that. They actually trade and track RECs. They are renewable energy credits. REC, and those are certificates that are actually traded, and they are they have a number, and they can only be used once, and they represent the generation of, say, solar, methane gas, or wind, hydropower. So when, let's say, hydropower creates energy, it's kind of sold off the actual energy, and then this certificate that represents the actual good qualities of that power, it's an entity that's tracked, it's sold, there's a number, it can only be used once, and it represents that power. So when you are purchasing a REC, you might still be getting your actual electron from a coal-generated plant, but you are supporting the renewable energy market, and that can represent, because, you know, once the electrons are in the grid, who knows where they came from. So your supplier can purchase that, and it sounds a little esoteric, but it's a way to support green resources.
Okay. I mean, answer my, I just was clear, to clarify, because when you said on the grid, that means everybody feeds the grid.
Exactly, yes.
Any other questions by board members? I do know we have some people in the audience, and a person did sign up just to, I guess, speak is Chris Cardera. You want to say a few words or ask a question? Or?
I have some questions.
Okay, please come to the podium. Just state your name and address for the record, please, and we'll do our best to answer the questions. I know somebody in the audience who has all the answers.
Well, that'd be cool. Hi, my name is Chris Carderas. I'm speaking as an individual. Thank you for the opportunity. I'm looking forward to this program. I think this is an interesting opportunity. I think the easiest way for me to ask a question is just kind of go section by section. I have specific things that I've outlined in the document that I'm curious about. First, there's an overall question that I have that I guess would refer to consumer education. There are certain programs that are offered through Commonwealth Edison at the present, you know, appliance recycling and various things like that. As we go to this aggregation program and we no longer are Exxon customers, do we still have opportunities to avail ourselves of those programs? Or are those programs that go away when we stop being Exxon customers? It's just, it's. I don't know the answer to that. And
I think I can answer that question. Basically, Exelon is the producer of the power.
Right.
ComEd is the provider of the infrastructure.
Right.
So we're still ComEd customers as far as the infrastructure.
Got
so
it.
The answer to that question is probably yes.
Okay.
Because
okay.
Well, we talk to ComEd.
Okay, that makes sense, and that sounds
if your power doesn't work, you call ComEd.
Right. There was some discussion earlier about an early exit fee or a termination fee, but at various points in the document, for example, on page 4, section 4A, number 1 for provider, it says there are no switching fees. So if there is a termination fee, that clause needs to be modified because a termination is a switching. And it says it in the cover letter, in the letter, the opt-out letter as well, that there's no switching fee. And that needs to be, either there is or there isn't.
Eric, you're taking notes on that, correct?
Yeah. Okay. On page 5, this is section 4A, number 4, customer service, talks about response time for telephone inquiries. Is telephone going to be the only way that you can contact the provider? Will there be email? Will there be a web form? And if so, can this just talk about response time to inquiries and not just telephone inquiries? So I'm just throwing that out as a question. Above that on the same page, section 3 for member education, there's information here that to notify the members about how the program works and things like that. There is also later in the document an Appendix A that talks about education. Could either this section reference Appendix A or could Appendix A just be included here and delete the appendix? I mean, saying the same thing in two different places, you know, people can get different perspectives on things. So I think it'd be better to say it once. On page 5, item number 6, the compliance process, the first sentence has a phrase in it that I've read this for 5 days and I can't understand what this phrase means. It says, the provider shall develop internal controls and processes to ensure that the village remains in good standing as a municipal aggregator. I don't have any idea what that means. In good standing with respect to whom? And the rest of the sentence makes a lot of sense. If you just delete that phrase and then continue with the rest of the sentence, it sounds great. So I just
your first question was easy.
The last one, I have no idea how to answer. That's probably we have staff for.
Okay, well, I wasn't expecting a dialogue. Yeah. I thought I'd just present these, and then staff would go off.
If that first one was easy.
Okay. Well, I appreciate that one. Going on to page 6, under the section that talks about solicitation of bids, there is item A, B, and C. Item A says the corporate authorities of the village may solicit bids for electricity or other related services. That makes sense. Items B and C have nothing to do with the solicitation of bids. They talk about information interchange between the provider and the village and who protects that information, but it doesn't talk about solicitation of bids. So this is probably important information, but it should be somewhere else. At the end of page 6, that goes into a section C, Village of Lisle's retail electric supplier, and there's a long bullet list that continues on to page 7. The second to the last bullet, assist the village in developing a consumer education plan. Again, Appendix A talks about education, so either reference Appendix A or slurp that stuff in here and get rid of the appendix. And the last bullet, assist the village in developing a smart meter program. I don't know anything about smart meters, but I know a lot of people are very upset about them. And so I'm not sure what smart meters has to do with the aggregation program. If this is a requirement, then say so. Otherwise, if this could be struck, that would be great. I think that's a separate discussion. Going on to page 8, again, when it talks about opt-out procedures in section 8, again, it talks about may not charge an early termination fee to any customer who opts out once they've begun to take service in the aggregation program. So again, different information. Either there is an opt-out fee or there might be or there will not be. This says there isn't any. And I think that's it.
Well, thank you, Chris, for bringing those questions, those items to our attention. Eric was busy writing it down, and our guest was also listening to those questions. So.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Thanks. Anybody else in the audience wants to have a question or make a comment in regards to electric aggregation? Let the record show that there is none. I'll go back to the board for any additional comments or anything.
What's the difference between option 1 and option 2 that I guess we're just supposed to decide tonight? What's the difference between option 1 and 2?
We're talking about the bid. Okay. Yeah.
Option 2 has more words to it.
Undeniably true.
Okay, excuse me, let me back up. I did not talk about the bid process. You could talk to Eric a bit about this. You could move forward if you'd like, if you're interested in more expediting to moving your residents to a switch sooner during the summer months when electric use is typically higher. And he's outlined a couple of ways that you could move more quickly, or if you choose to, if you want residents to be able to have more time to think about it, to come to the next public hearing and respond after the next public hearing. But there was thought given to having a public hearing at the next meeting presenting a second ordinance, which the board would require to pass to move forward toward an aggregation program. And if it were your pleasure, we could present prices at that board hearing. That's moving things pretty quickly. If you want to move, no need to, and that was just an option presented versus just having a public hearing and then passing an ordinance that evening or at a later time and moving forward.
Well, I think it was our direction to move this along as quickly as possible. So, and I'm not sure I still under the difference between option 1 and option 2. But I think the board's direction was move it quickly. So
I think option 1, if I understand it correctly, was that there would be a bid on that day and the board would in fact authorize it at that evening.
At the next public meeting.
Option 2 actually gives me the authority, be it June 4th, June 5th or later,
the next day to
enter into the agreement based on the timing of the bids.
That's how I understood it.
But if you're prepared to have them bid on the 4th and look at it that night, then that's obviously the most expedited version.
Well, I think.
However, if there's a better bid come in and the village manager has the option to grab that bid.
You got to have the bidding deadline. You're going to make it the morning of the 5th, right? Or the 4th.
Well, and you can obviously decline the bid too,
right,
on the 4th.
We could. We could. I'm sorry. We could present bids on. I didn't read the. I hadn't seen the two options, the difference either. But we could present to you live prices at the board meeting. It would be the public hearing, second ordinance, and then you could have a vote on actual live prices. Or if you pass the ordinance and then wanted to give authorization to the village manager, we would bring pricing as early as the next day. So it'd be a matter of, would you like to see the prices live, or we could present them as early as the next day or at any point after that.
It's prices
do you advise?
Because one of the bids might have green or whatever in it. So we are going to have apples and oranges that night, correct? All the bids won't be exactly the same. There's going to be differences.
I can respond to that. We will present what I'll call base, let's call it brown or conventional energy prices from all the suppliers for 1 year, 2 year, and 3 year. Then you may select, say, supplier ABC. Once you choose supplier ABC, then we'll break it down and show you their broken down pricing of zero, added, 25% added, 50 or 100% green. So that's the way we break out the pricing matrix to make it simpler for you.
Well, I think it would be to our advantage to try to get some portion of green or renewable energy in the process mix so we can, you know, at least try to save the environment somewhat.
Depending on the cost.
Well, right. Absolutely the cost. But I do know as another municipality, they went a very high percentage of renewable energy, and it only cost them less than 1 cent per kilowatt.
Typically 9/10 of a penny.
That's what they told me, yeah.
So if you did just say 25%, if you thought we'll do partial, 25% might be 1 or 2 tenths. I'm giving you rough, but yeah. 1 or 2 tenths of a penny, which, you know, maybe $1 per resident per year, $2 per resident per year, just to put it into live.
What option would you recommend we take here?
Whatever your village manager is interested in. You know, we're open, and if you'd like to, you know, discuss the pricing and look at them, we're thrilled with that. If you'd like Mr. Sprecher the next day to look at the prices and determine in his best judgment, you can give him parameters, you know, 3 years or less or no early termination fee.
I think the bottom line is if you're prepared to close the next public hearing on June 4th and then immediately consider a bid, that's the quickest route, and we'll be happy to do that.
I think that makes most sense, Okay.
As long as we get the breakdown of how the sourcing comes, that'd be interesting.
We would present you with pricing matrices, and we're happy to do either. It's, you know, at your pleasure or whatever.
I think part of the thought process was whether or not the board was willing to do this on the same evening that we have the second public hearing, but if that's not an issue...
If we have the information and if we can understand it, I think it's
but we won't get that information until we get here that evening, right?
Correct.
Right. But if we show up a half an hour early, we can be on the dais and we can go through it quickly. Okay. I move to proceed with bid documents for electric supply procurement consistent with option one of the May 16th staff correspondence.
Second.
Well, I think we have to close the public hearing first, don't we?
Oops.
Yeah. I think you have to close the public hearing. Can I have a motion to close the public hearing first?
So moved.
Second.
There's a motion and second. Hearing no further discussion, all those in favor saying aye.
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 Those opposed? Hearing none, the public hearing is closed.
Now I move to proceed with bid documents for electric supply procurement consistent with option one of the May 16th staff correspondence.
Second.
Second.
There's a motion and second. Hearing no further discussion, all those in favor saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? Hearing none, motion carries. Move on to the next agenda item, which happens to be open forum. Does anybody wish to speak at open forum that did not sign up tonight? Let the record.
Presentation?
I'm sorry. I got to back up. I'm going back up to the previous agenda item, presentation for the proposed TIF redevelopment district. I believe we have somebody here to speak to that tonight. Thank you for catching that, Manager Sprecher.
I think I was first. Yes, okay. Good evening, Russ Whitaker. I'm an attorney at the law firm of Rosenova and Whitaker, 23 West Jefferson Street, Suite 200, Naperville, Illinois. Here this evening on behalf of Universal Technical Institute. Universal Technical Institute, commonly known as UTI, is a leading provider nationally in post-secondary education for students seeking careers as auto, diesel industrial technology, collision repair, motorcycle, and marine mechanics. UTI has 11 campuses throughout 8 states, including a Midwest region located in Glendale Heights. UTI is proud of its educational tradition, having educated or graduated over 150,000 students over a 46-year history. This tradition is built on strong graduation rates, exceptional job placement rates for recent graduates. Over the last couple of years, UTI has been evaluating possible relocation of that Glendale Heights campus. The lease on that campus is nearing end of term. They've been at the campus approximately 24 years, so an extension at that campus is going to require significant reinvestment into existing facilities. And frankly, the Glendale Heights campus doesn't fit well with the educational model that has evolved since they first opened that campus nearly 2.5 decades ago. At the time that the Glendale Heights campus was built, UTI was first entering the Chicago market. The campus was built incrementally with a single building to start with, and over the last 24 years, they've added 5 additional buildings to a campus that consists of 5 or 6 buildings today. So from a business perspective, they have some issues in Glendale Heights with respect to the location, the visibility, the marketing, the location of buildings being spread, efficiencies in business operation, efficiencies in management of the campus, et cetera. So over the last 2 years, they've evaluated approximately 50 sites over 5 different counties. The top of their list is a property in Lisle, commonly known as 2611 Corporate West Drive. The property fits them well for a long list of reasons: tollway adjacency, access onto both Warrenville Road and to the tollway, an existing housing stock in Lisle that fits student needs, a position of the property relative to existing past student bases, position of the property relative to what they see as growth markets for students, and also the position of the property relative to automotive partners and anticipated student employers. However, existing improvements on the property create extraordinary development costs that UTI is unable to assume as part of its contemplated relocation. I know that some of you have had the opportunity to visit the building that currently occupies the property. I think the eligibility report does a good job of conveying the condition of the building, but I would certainly encourage each of you to take an hour to visit the site, to get a tour of the building. If there's any doubt left in your mind as to the condition of the building, I'm sure that site tour will remove any doubt. To suggest that the building is obsolete, I think, is the best we could say about it. Accordingly, we have proposed a TIF to help bridge the divide and to help cover the unique legacy costs associated with this property, many of those costs associated with existing improvements. I've been told I should stop calling them improvements because they're not improvements to the property at this point in time, but I guess it's my attorney nomenclature. So with that said, on behalf of UTI, we appreciate the village's indulgence in evaluating tax increment financing. We understand that this is something that can engender significant discussion and emotion in a community. We're at a point right now where we ask for approval of ordinances, not in order to create a TIF district or finalize a TIF district or to give us money, but we ask for ordinance approval tonight to begin the process of public hearings, to begin the process of public discourse, a process that we expect will cover the course primarily of the summer. We look forward in engaging the community and explaining what we believe to be a very solid case for continued investment in the redevelopment of Lisle's corridor. We believe that the proposed development will provide a multitude of direct and indirect benefits to the community. Those benefits include such things as a $40 million direct investment in the village, beneficial use of a long-term dormant property, productive educational use that will provide an employee base for local businesses and an essential service for local residents, new resident population for many local apartment complexes, and significant new spending in the village. We appreciate your time and consideration this evening. We do ask that you move forward on the ordinances this evening to keep us on track with scheduling. As you may be aware, last week, we moved out of the Plan Commission with the entitlement request associated with the property. And even earlier tonight, you approved a ordinance for a text amendment, which facilitates the educational type use that we're suggesting occur in the corridor, which in fact does already occur in the corridor. So with that, I'll defer additional comment on the specifics of the proposal for appropriate time during joint review board, public hearing, other discourse on the project, and I'd be happy to answer any questions you might have at this preliminary juncture.
Thank you for a very detailed review of the process, Russ. Anybody have any questions from the board?
I move to approve an ordinance proposing approval of redevelopment plan and project for the 2611 Corporate Drive UTI TIF redevelopment district, the designation of redevelopment project area, and the adoption of a tax increment allocation financing, therefore convening a joint review board and calling a public hearing in connection therewith.
Second. There's a motion and second. Hearing no further discussion, all those in favor, think we're saying aye.
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 Do I need a roll call on this? Yes, I need a roll call. Would you please take the roll? I'm sorry.
Trustee Young?
Aye.
Trustee Boyle?
Aye.
Trustee Kowitzel?
Aye.
Trustee LaFon?
Aye.
Trustee Monaff?
Aye.
Trustee Schmidt?
Aye.
And motion carries. Okay, thank you very much. Moving on to our next agenda item, we'll go to now the open forum. Is there anyone in the audience that wishes to speak that did not sign up tonight? Let the record show that there's none. Moving on to our agenda tonight, we'll go to village staff.
Nothing this evening, Mayor.
Village attorney.
Nothing.
Trustee Boyle.
Nothing tonight, thank you.
Trustee Kowitzel.
No, thank you.
Trustee LaFon.
Nothing, Mr. Mayor.
Trustee Moraff.
Nothing, thanks.
Trustee Schmidt.
Nothing, Mr. Mayor, thank you.
And Trustee Young.
Nothing, thank you.
We have nothing for executive session. The next item on our agenda is the motion for adjournment.
So moved.
Second.
There's a motion and second. Hearing no further discussion, we are adjourned. All those in favor, by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, hearing none, motion carries. We are adjourned.